Thank you, children and youth. Thank you, Jody. Thanks, everybody. That is a Pentecost song. Send down the fire of your justice. Where are the, just can somebody give me the lyrics to that? Nancy, can I just borrow that? I'll just read this again from my sermon. A little joke. I have to confess that, well, it's not a confession, I'm proud of it, y'all. Something happened 50 days after Passover. So Passover, you know, that's when Christ was crucified, resurrected. In today's reading from the Acts of the Apostles, it tells us that we learn that Jesus was probably around for about 40 days after his resurrection. So his ascension would have been about 10 days before everyone gathered in Jerusalem for the celebration of Pentecost. Pente, Greek, 550. It's a powerful notion. And we know that in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit is spoken of. It's used the word ruach. We know that Paul, I love the passage that Paul, where he talks about when we don't have words for prayer, that the Spirit breaks in with sighs too deep for words. But I'll tell you, it's still a confusing notion to me. You know, God, somehow I get, somebody had to create all of this, and Jesus, I get, he came flesh and blood, but this Holy Spirit thing, it sometimes seems nebulous, and in that, we may take it for granted a little bit. But one of the things that today's passage does for us is to remind us that in that day, when all were gathered, at least 120 and probably more, the Holy Spirit rained down equally on everyone. That made it a just spirit because it rained down on everyone equally. But some of the rest of it is a little bit hard to consume. Not hard, but different. Why preach a sermon about Pentecost? There are a lot of reasons. For one thing, it's miraculous what happened on that day. Don't worry, we'll read the passage in just a moment. It was evidence that Jesus keeps his promises, as if we didn't already need that and the community there didn't need it. It was helpful because he had said he would send an advocate. It's a powerful introduction to the third person of the Trinity. And we don't talk about that nearly enough in the Protestant church. But it is our great model for community, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And about that Holy Spirit, it is perhaps the most elusive of all, isn't it? When you find yourself using that language for at least for a while, for the next few days, if you find yourself using that language or thinking about it, hit the pause button for just a moment and just stop and say, okay, I used it. I talked about the Holy Spirit. What did I mean? Why did I call on the Holy Spirit? What do I think it can do that God and Jesus are not already doing for me? It is perhaps the most elusive of all. Non-believers who may deny talk about a Holy Spirit or deny talk about the existence of a creator and a son, they will talk about this. They'll talk about synergy. They'll talk about pure energy, synchronicity, karma. Now, all those things are fine. I kind of accept the evidence for those things as well. It's just that I call it something else. And I hope you do too. It's the Holy Spirit. So when that person is talking to you about synchronicity and karma, oh, you mean the Holy Spirit? Well, no, I don't mean that. Well, hit the pause button and help them learn, not so that they might believe, but so that they might know you believe. Here's the passage from Acts. You'll find it on the back of your bulletin. And this morning, we're reading from the translation, The Message. And y'all, I'm reading it all, so just relax. When the Feast of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And without warning, there was a sound like a strong wind gale force. No one could tell where it came from. It filled the whole building. And then, like a wildfire, the Holy Spirit spread through their ranks, and they started speaking in a number of different languages as the Spirit prompted them. Okay, now here's your cue. Go like this. Come on, let me hear it, everybody. Keep doing it. You got to keep doing it. There were many Jews staying in Jerusalem just then, devout pilgrims from all over the world. And when they heard the sound, they came on the run. And then they were heard one after another, their own mother tongues being spoken. They were thunderstruck. They couldn't for the life of them figure out what was going on and kept saying, "Aren't these all Galileans? How come we're hearing them talk in our various mother languages, mother tongues? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, visitors from Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, immigrants from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, even Cretans and Arabs. They're speaking our languages, describing God's mighty works." And the Spirit died down. Their heads were spinning. They couldn't make head or tail of any of it. They talked back and forth, confused. "What's going on?" And others joked, "They're drunk. Cheap wine." That's when Peter stood up and backed by the other 11, spoke out with bold urgency. "Fellow Jews, all of you who are visiting Jerusalem, listen carefully and get this story straight. These people aren't drunk, as some of you suspect. They haven't had time to get drunk. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning." Okay, some of you take exception to that, I can tell. "They haven't had time to get drunk. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. This is what the prophet Joel announced would happen. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on every kind of people. Your sons will prophesy, also your daughters. Your young men will see visions. Your old men dream dreams. When the time comes, I'll pour out my spirit on those who serve me, men and women both, and they'll prophesy. I'll set wonders in the sky above and signs on the earth below. Blood and fire and billowing smoke, the sun turning black and the moon blood red. Before the day of the Lord arrives, the day tremendous and marvelous. And whoever calls out for help to me, God, will be saved." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Now you see why I wear the red stole that shows the fire coming down and the doves, and it says rejoice, because this was a powerful day. It was a turning point in the life of this new community of faith. And we've kind of lost our sense of appreciation for the Holy Spirit, I think. Maybe not you, but I know sometimes I have. It's an almost unbelievable occurrence. On Pentecost, a celebration that took place 50 days after Passover, Jerusalem is once again full of people, just like at Passover. And they're from all over the known world. Jewish folk there to celebrate, and even non-Jewish folk from the area who had immigrated in from other countries. They'd come to Jerusalem to make their life. And now, about 10 days after the ascension of Jesus, the disciples, one man down, added Matthias, and around 120 more, and a powerful journey began at the very place where they had known their Savior to be crucified. There are other occurrences of what would come to be known as the Holy Spirit, falling like wind and fire onto both individuals and groups. But here's what makes this passage different. This time at Pentecost, when those gathered received this infusion of the Holy Spirit, they speak in other tongues. Now, they're not speaking in tongues, okay? We're not talking about glossolalia, is the 25-cent word. But they're speaking in other tongues, in other languages, foreign languages, their languages. One might say that there was literally a worldwide audience. And all present that day actually could hear and comprehend the same message because they hear and comprehend it in their own language. If you've ever been to the UN as a visitor, in the gallery, or if you've ever been to General Conference before, the United Methodist Church, there's a booth of translators, and you can see people all over the arenas. They've got their headsets in, and they've got the translator there letting them know everything that's being said. But what would happen if at one of those occasions, and Lord, we need it to happen at General Conference in February, what would happen if the Holy Spirit just blew through like fire and suddenly headsets could be pulled off and Palestinians and Jews could hear the same? And gay folk and straight folk could hear the same way. And non-believers and believers would hear the same message of hope and compassion and a power greater than anything to bring us together. The power of the Holy Spirit. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of hearing about doom and gloom in the United Methodist Church. Because I believe that the Holy Spirit is still at work. On that day, there was a worldwide audience, and all present could hear and comprehend the same message because they heard it in their own language. And the magnitude of this miracle is so significant that the writer of Acts takes the time to list all the nations represented that day. Were y'all impressed how I ran through that so quickly? I only mispronounced one or two of those. But it was so important that the writer listed all of those. We're not sure who the writer was, but probably the same person who wrote Luke wrote Acts. They worked together. Fred Craddock tells us that on this day, the new community of Christ is made legitimate through a divine sign. It is audible and visible. It falls on the community equally, and it creates a new community equally. A new community of Christ is made legitimate through a divine sign. It's audible, it's visible. All believers being together, and Jews from every nation, it is the great unity of the community. Now, the church didn't have to start off that way. It didn't. It could have simply been a message to the Gentiles or just to whoever might happen to listen, but in a very profound way on a day when God knew people from every nation would be present. That's the day that God decided to say, I'm going to send my Holy Spirit because I need to do it when everybody's there so that everyone can see and hear the power that falls equally on everyone. The Holy Spirit was the great equalizer that day. And you know what? It's the great equalizer today, too. We can differ on so many things. We can differ on politics. We can differ on, you know, green olives versus black olives. We can differ on fried chicken or grilled chicken. We can differ on a literal interpretation of the Bible or a more contextual interpretation. We can differ on matters of race and racial reconciliation. We can differ on matters of gun control. And yet, there is something that is larger than all of our differences. We know that it is the love of Christ given to us in this holy meal and celebrated today. But it is made palpable and powerful every day of our lives. You know what we're missing, though? We're missing that visual and audible sign, right? Fred Craddock said that the community became one because of a divine occurrence that happened both audibly and visibly. I don't know about you, but I've been looking around for some of that. And you know what? I found it. I see it. It's true that in this 21st century field of faith, I get confused and I get busy in my brain and I don't pay attention as I should. But when I pay attention and when I remember it's not one or the other, that it is the three in one, then I see signs. I see signs. I see signs on Tuesday morning. I see signs when I've disappointed someone in this church, and you know what? They forgive me. I see signs when someone in my family has disappointed me, and I forgive them. I'm not doing that. It is the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, folks, we are living in a divided nation right now, aren't we? Sadly. Just so much fracturing going on, even within the church to a certain degree. That's why this celebration of Pentecost, perhaps to me, is more important now than ever before. I need a reminder that people that are that different can have the same Holy Spirit fall upon them and hold them together. This is the message of the church. It's our message by birthright. Are we sharing that message? Let's share it. I don't know how exactly or when or how you might do it in your own life, but let's find a way to share it. Let's find a way to model for the rest of the world that, you know what? Yes, we can all get along. We may not agree, but we will never walk away in hate because the Holy Spirit holds us together in love. And I just feel like if the world out there could hear that message a little more clearly, it might be a new heaven on earth. new heaven on earth is made evident in a broken body and a spilt cup. There was one loaf broken, that there might now be one body, us, healed. And so we share this holy meal, blessed by the Holy Spirit, and reminded that we are one in the Spirit. Pour out your Holy Spirit, Almighty God, on these gifts of bread and wine. And as we gather at this altar from all walks of life, every political persuasion, every hue, every origin, every difference of opinion, we gather in the bonds of love that your Holy Spirit shares in this holy meal. May it be for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ, that redeemed by this body and this blood, we might be a shining vision of the redemptive Holy Spirit for the world beyond, and a reminder for one another right here in this place. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.